And now, without any further ado, I'm going to introduce our very first speaker. What I'm going to do is not give you a list of speakers, but have you meet the speaker right before they come up so that you don't have to remember. So Peter Jaffe is our first speaker. He spoke in Albany. I was introduced to him through the National Council of Juvenile and Family Court Judges in an advanced training for judges about domestic or intimate partner violence. And he's mesmerizing. He brings such exuberance to his energy, to his research, to his dedication to working to make victims into survivors. And he has some startling information for us today. So Dr. Jaffe is a psychologist in profession in the Faculty of Education at Western University and the academic director of the Center for Research and Education on Violence Against Women and Children. He is also the director emeritus for the Center for Children and Families in the Justice System, which is a children's mental health center specializing in issues that bring children and families into the justice system in London, Ontario. He's co-authored 10 books, 24 chapters, and over 75 articles related to violence and abuse involving children, adults, families, and the justice system. Included in your materials is a very thoughtful article that Dr. Jaffe has co-authored, and he really talks about systematic analysis of how to help families, how to help parents continue to safely be parents after they're no longer partners in contexts where intimate partner violence has occurred. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Jaffe.
Thank you very much for that kind introduction. I hope I can live up to it. Actually, I have four boys, three still at home, and they have an attention span of about 20 seconds when I speak, so I like to tape what you said and play to them all my skills to engage people. You know, usually with them, it's like, Dad, get to your point, you know. So, but fortunately, I have till 10:30 to get to my point today, which is wonderful. As you know from the introduction, I'm in London, Ontario, which is only 2.5 hours away from here. So if you were driving to Detroit and you headed up towards Toronto and then made a left turn, you'd pass through London. It was easy coming in. I was a bit worried. You know, it's always nerve-wracking crossing into the U.S. from Canada. You don't know what to expect. A lot of questions, a lot of ideas. They did ask me last night when I came in whether I had appropriate American values, whether I could come into the country. And I was a bit nervous, and I said, what do you mean? And they said, well, do you support the Buffalo Bills? And I said, yes, I always had great sympathy for the Bills. And all the Super Bowls. I am a Bills fan, and I still remember crying when the field goal was missed years ago. It's a bad, traumatic memory for many of you, too. But I try to get involved in domestic violence, take my mind off the Bills. On a more serious, Jeff asked me to talk about where we were, where we're now, and the work ahead. And I will try to reflect on those questions. I should let you know at the outset, I don't have any answers, so those of you taking notes, you can stop. I've come to pose questions, but actually the article that Judge Pearl kindly referred to is probably the best piece of literature in terms of some of our thinking in the field. And when I say it's the best, I wrote it with another psychologist, a law professor, and another researcher, and we argued over every sentence. I can tell you, actually, the article won an award. And it wasn't because I was brilliant, it was because I worked across disciplines and we argued every word we wrote, every sentence we had to qualify, we had to agree on the meaning. It's the most painful article, but it's a good article because we reached consensus. I prefer to write by myself where I don't have to argue so much. even though sometimes when you write and then you testify in court, you wish he hadn't said things a certain way. I hate when I testify in court and the lawyer has a book I wrote or an article. It's got a yellow highlighter and question marks and put what I used to think before me. If any of you taking notes, hoping to cross-examine me when I appear somewhere in a New York State court, I may change my mind and there may be new literature. So where were we and where are we going? So I thought I'd start, the picture's always worth 1,000 words. So, you know, as Dan said, you know, in 1980s and before, we were in denial. We didn't really understand the problem. People asked us for advice. You know, we hoped the problem would go away. We really didn't talk very much about the issue of domestic violence. You could probably, in 1980, you could probably go to the library and ask the librarian for all the books on domestic violence and all the scholarly articles, and you wouldn't find very many. Today, you type the words domestic violence into an internet search, and you'll find 2 million hits. You'll find websites and articles and books dedicated to abusers, to victims, survivors, to children living with violence. So keeping up today gets more and more complicated. So clearly we've gone from not really talking about it, and when I talk about not talking about it, it was a painful topic. It's a painful topic today, but even back then, it wasn't safe. I was part of a national panel in 1993. We visited 190 communities across Canada talking about this issue more broadly around violence against women. And we often had to meet with security guards. We had to meet in church basements. It wasn't a topic that you were even safe addressing. So we've come a long way, even though there's certainly an ongoing struggle. But today when we talk about these issues, especially in the family court context, it's still not easy because you still get asked the same questions about when you finally do have a disclosure of domestic violence, what does it mean? Is it really somebody who's unsafe or is it somebody who's alienating the kids against the other parent? And that's the issue I'm gonna keep coming back to because we do struggle to really understand violence and what it means. I've been at this a long time, and just to leave no doubt, to leave no doubt in your mind that I know and have forgotten an awful lot. I dealt with my first domestic violence case in 1973, so that's like 43 years ago, more than 43 years ago. So we had a very innovative chief of police. He identified in London, Ontario, a community of 350,000 people. Domestic violence calls were second only to motor vehicle accidents. It was the most common request for emergency police services. And he felt the police didn't have the appropriate training in the background to manage it. So he developed a civilian unit. We were called the family consultants. He hired psychologists, social workers, and also people with nursing backgrounds. We had an unmarked police car. We were car 54 back in those days, I believe, and we were unmarked police car, police radio. We responded to domestic violence calls. The police went first. They arrested somebody, which was rare in those days. They removed weapons. And we were there left to counsel the victims, the perpetrators, and the children. And we had no idea what we were doing because there wasn't really a lot of research. Back then, the only theory was really around family crisis intervention. You know, a stitch in time saves nine. If you could get involved early enough with the family, you might be able to make a referral and get interventions in place. One of the challenges, of course, was that there was no place to refer people to. So you could get referrals to mental health counselors, but I think as Dan very eloquently talked about, you know, trying to do research even in 1980 on treatment of abusers, there weren't a lot of services. So in our community, we spent a lot of time developing services for abusers, for victims, for children living with violence. My colleague David Wolf and I did a lot of research starting in the 1980s on children exposed to domestic violence. So a lot has developed, and so we've certainly come a long way, but we've a long way to go. But it's been exhausting. How many of you doing this work get exhausted? How many feel exhausted? How many of you know what compassion fatigue and vicarious trauma is? How many of you are in denial? Just a couple of you still. So the work is exhausting, and I have good days and bad days, and this is a good day because I love being here, and you know, I think as as Jeff and Dan both said, it's so exciting to be part of an interdisciplinary group, fun to be part of AFCC because you get so many different perspectives and you feel like you are moving the yardstick, so to speak. But the work is exhausting. Here's a picture of me going home from work last Friday. Many of you can probably, how many can relate to this picture? How many look like this on a Friday? How many look like this on a Monday? This is a, how many identify more with the horse than the rider? It's a psychological test. If you look at that and you feel badly for the horse, what it means is that you are coping adequately with vicarious trauma, compassion fatigue, but you're surrounded by people who are very burnt out. Because burnout and compassion fatigue is contagious. So even though you're doing your best, if you're surrounded by people who are, you know, feeling depressed and hopeless, they can wear you down. It's contagious. So it's a reminder to both look after yourself as well as look after others. I always say, you know, if you're always when I talk to judges about vicarious trauma, I give a lot of talks to judges and lawyers around vicarious trauma, compassion fatigue, and they're a very important group to address because as psychologists and social workers and psychiatrists, you know, we learn early on about our baggage, how the work affects us. You know, we get encouraged to get involved in support groups, counseling. When you're in law, and if you're a judge, other than a judge with a psychology degree, when you focus on the law, you can forget how the work affects you. You can forget about feelings and the impact of the work. And, you know, I work with a lot of judges, prosecutors, police officers who feel if you can't take the heat, get out of the kitchen, basically. And they don't really get a chance to really talk about how they feel and how the work affects them. So it's really critical that we find ways to support each other. Because if you were depressed and you went to a counselor who seemed more depressed than you, you wouldn't go back for a second visit. Is that fair to say? If you were a victim or survivor of violence and you went to a lawyer, call a police officer, went to a therapist who looked more hopeless and helpless than you were, felt you wouldn't go back a second time. You'd think there were no resources for you. So looking after ourselves is not a selfish act. It's actually a way to be more effective with the clients we serve. Some good news. Actually, a judge I work with in Duluth sent me an article recently. And it was a review article about what we know about dealing with burnout, compassion fatigue, and vicarious trauma. And one of the findings, and this is actually focused more on therapists, but I think it's a universal finding. It's one of the key things is being a lifelong learner. A way to deal with compassion fatigue is being a lifelong learner and always be thinking about personal professional effectiveness. I mean, being part of a conference like this with people in different disciplines. And I love this quote in the summary of the article at the end. It talks about burnout isn't related to caring too much, but continuing to care ineffectively. So what the article talks about is we have to always try to be better at what we do, evaluate what we do, think of new strategies, just doing the same thing over and over again. Caring too much isn't the problem. It's caring ineffectively, not thinking about the things you do that have an impact. When I think about where we've come over the last 40 years in my experience, and this is sort of the part of the talk about, you know, kind of where have we been. And I also mention it because sometimes some of us are still back there. And it's always amazing to me when I see things in the media where I think people really haven't learned very much. So although some of us are moving forward, we have to remember there's people around us who are still living in a different generation and haven't adopted the same lessons. We now know that domestic violence affects the whole community. We used to have stereotypes that it was, you know, it was people who were poor, drunk, lived on the wrong side of the tracks, the wrong side of the river. We now know it goes across all areas of the community. In our community, we had a murder-suicide involving two police officers a number of years ago. It was a wake-up call to all police officers. We ended up doing a lot of research on violence by police. You know, how do the helpers also become involved in these issues? So it used to be it was us and them. It was a great kind of unwashed masses out there that had the problem, but we were all okay. We had a doctor in a local hospital, anesthetist, kill a nurse in the operating room. They had a dating relationship. They broke up. He continued to stalk and harass her for 2 years after the breakup. Everybody saw there was at least, testified at the inquest on this case. There was at least 34 things that happened in the hospital, incidents, events, words said, notes left on cars. And everybody looked the other way. Now, why would people look the other way in a hospital when a doctor's abusing a nurse? Because he had status, because he was still a competent doctor. It didn't affect his job performance. People thought it was their personal business. No one was going to say anything. There was a long list. There was like 10 excuses that people gave as to why they didn't intervene or say anything. And that simply, we know that that's not good enough. And actually, in our jurisdiction, they've actually changed health and safety legislation that now says that domestic violence is actually a workplace issue. So part of our health and safety legislation in Ontario now says that if an employer knows or ought to know that somebody's dealing with domestic violence, they have a responsibility to respond to the issues, to provide support, to provide help. And it's had, that tragedy had a number of implications in terms of changing the laws, which is significant. Actually, on that issue, we know now, all of you probably, whether you're a football fan or not, followed the issues with Ray Rice, football player of the Baltimore Ravens, who lost his job because of domestic violence. And not only did he lose his job, there were people lined up outside the Baltimore Ravens stadium returning jerseys that had Ray Rice on it because they wanted their money back, because they didn't want to support somebody who would be abusive. Major League Baseball told every team after the Ray Rice incident in football, Major League Baseball told every team that they had to do prevention programs on domestic violence and sexual violence. I was hired by the Toronto Blue Jays to talk to all of their staff. They had an expert in Florida meet with them at spring training, meet with the players, but I met with 420 staff in small groups. I met with everybody from HR people, groundskeepers, security, marketing people. Everybody who was worked for the Toronto Blue Jays had to understand domestic violence and sexual violence because it was seen as such a critical issue to understand the issue in the workplace. So again, although we've come a long way, I always like to remember the positive things that happened in terms of how the world has changed. Now people are thinking about these issues. I think the one challenge, if I think about where we were and where we're going, is really having to address this issue well within the family court. The family court, I'm not, you know, there. I mean, we have incredible judges, one right beside me, some in the room. So I'm not, I want to be cautious when I generalize. For the most part, we've come a long way, but we still, generally speaking, in family law, are really struggling to really understand the issue of domestic violence. You know, in criminal law now, in my jurisdiction, in criminal law, we have specialized prosecutors, we have specialized police officers. In my jurisdiction, if a police respond to domestic violence, they have to do risk assessment. When people come to court, the prosecutor ensures there's victim services in place. People develop a safety plan. So the criminal justice system has made great, great advances in dealing with issues around domestic violence. In family law, it's still every man and woman for themselves, for the most part. It's hard getting access to good legal assistance. It's hard getting access to good assessments. Generally speaking, it's a very different reality. I sit on a domestic violence death review committee that reviews every domestic homicide in Ontario. One of our first cases we reviewed was a woman whose daughter was killed by her ex-husband. Her ex-husband couldn't get access to her, but he continued to get access to her child because there was a court order enabling him to have access to the child. She came to our committee to talk about what she went through. And she said to me, it was a small group of us who interviewed her, said, you know, when I went to the criminal court, you know, I had a prosecutor who was a specialist, I had a police officer, I had a safety plan, I had a whole circle of support around me. I went to a different courtroom in the same courthouse, in the family court, and I had a judge who said to me, if I was going to have custody, I had to promote contact with the other parent, that I had to forgive and forget, I had to move on. you know, I was separating as a wife, but I was going to be a co-parent forever. I had to work together with this man, you know, who hurt me in so many different ways. She said, you know, on the second floor, I had a safety plan. On the third floor, I had a plan that endangered me. And there was a tragic outcome. So I mention that because it's not an exceptional story, because I think more and more the challenge in the family court is how do we recognize domestic violence, how do we respond, how do we enhance safety and support. We still struggle with questions. You know, we ask, you know, why did she stay so long? You know, was that bad? And I still get asked those questions. I wish these were questions I got in 1990 or 1980, but I still get them today. People can't believe that somebody stays in an abusive relationship. You know, didn't she care about the child? Was that bad? Why would she stay? You know, why is she reporting now? We're very, very suspicious when people report years later, you know. I get child custody evaluations, and somebody, you know, I assess both partners. I ask lots of detailed questions about the history. I ask men and women about the history of violence, you know. I don't have gender bias. I love men. I have four sons. I am not against men. I'm against violence. I love men. I love women. I love parents. I want to help people. This is not a gender war, but somehow it often turns into a gender war. You know, why is she telling us this now? So I write reports saying that somebody finally feels safe because they're out of the relationship. And I do a structured inventory about all the different forms of violence that may take place in the relationship. There's a great questionnaire that Marianne Dutton developed years ago. So I talk about every form of violence, physical violence, sexual violence, emotional abuse, financial abuse, injuries. So I ask both husband and wife, both a couple, or it could be a same-sex relationship. Violence also happens, and with two men or two women in a relationship, I go through all the issues. And then I write a detailed report about the history and obviously the accounts, the credibility of the accounts. Sometimes, you know, she's told her doctor, sometimes she hasn't. Sometimes she's told her best friend or she's told her sister. So the information comes out. Sometimes she's never told anybody about the sexual abuse. Sometimes she's never talked about being forced to watch pornography or being coerced into sexual behavior. So I talk about what sexual coercion is, what sexual assault is. It's in the report. And when I come to court, do you think anybody's waiting for me to say, thank you, Dr. Jaffe. We now know the whole story. Thank you very much for being here. Nobody ever says that. Nobody ever says that. What they usually say is, really? If it was that bad, why didn't she tell somebody a long time ago? Why didn't she leave? There was a police station only 2 miles down the road. Why didn't she go there? She had an employee assistance program at work. Why didn't she tell them? You know, why is it now? So we look at great skepticism with somebody who discloses violence in the middle of a child custody hearing. We wonder, why is it now? They're trying to get one leg up. Even in progressive states, there's lots of progressive states on the East Coast and the West Coast. Not sure about the middle of the country. Just saying, that's a joke. Anybody from Nebraska, I don't mean to offend you. But there are problems in Nebraska. But if you think about the issues, like, you know, why are we surprised when somebody finally tells us the whole story? And why are we suspicious? Statistically, here's a statistic, here's a basic, you know, the fundamental context of our work. Most abuse victims never call the police, you know. Two-thirds of abuse victims don't call the police. Most don't report to somebody in a position of authority. So by the time things come to court, you're not going to find the official record to have clear and compelling evidence, you know, for a judge or a custody evaluator. So the reality, we're dealing with a problem that's often hidden. So the reality is we often don't have the documentation, and it takes really thoughtful assessments and thoughtful questions from judges, from lawyers, from mental health professionals to try to understand what happened. And obviously we have to be alert to the possibility of alienation. Alienation, it's not a syndrome. We know that it's not ever been accepted as a proper diagnosis, but alienating behavior does happen. Parents badmouth other parents. Alienation is a phenomenon. Alienating behavior is a bad thing. I think every you know, cereal box should have a warning on it that says, do not alienate, you know, do not alienate the kids against the other parent. It should be on billboards. We should be against alienation. However, we shouldn't have a knee-jerk reaction to believe that every time somebody tells us a credible story about a history of domestic violence, that we go to the issue of alienation as what's behind it. Just to give you a sense of some of the things we struggle with, I'm going to show you two clips. I always think that pictures and brief video clips really tell a story better than research can. This is, I'm going to show you two clips from a movie called Pay It Forward. Many of you have seen it, but you probably haven't seen it with fresh eyes. One clip in the movie, for those of you who haven't seen it, it stars Helen Hunt. In the movie, she's married an abuser named Bon Jovi. She keeps leaving him and going back. She has a son named Trevor, and Trevor is a classroom teacher played by Kevin Spacey, who grew up with violence himself. And Kevin Spacey becomes an advocate for Trevor. Actually, in the movie, Kevin Spacey also falls in love with Helen Hunt. I'm not suggesting that as a solution for as an intervention. Just remind all of you, put professional boundaries. Love cures all, but not as a therapist or a lawyer. But in the movie, I'm going to show you two clips. One where she's telling Kevin Spacey that she decided to go back. You know, going back to a batterer is a triumph of hope over experience. Going back to a batterer is a triumph of hope over experience. You're wishing and hoping that he's going to change, but he, more often than not, doesn't. I'm also going to show you the following scene, what happens when she goes back. And I'm just going to discuss with you some of the important things from these clips and what they reflect about our work and about the research in this field. I'm going to move to the scene where she goes back, then we'll talk about these briefly.
Hey. What's going on? What are you doing?
Hey. I still won't
turn to get.
So I want you to just reflect on those. If we had more time, I'd ask for a full day, but Jeff just gave me an hour and a half. If we had more time, we'd process this. So let me go inside your minds for a moment and process this with you. First thing to think about in the scene when, as Helen Hunt is telling Kevin Spacey that she's going back, think about all the reason that she's going back, you know. She's going back, you know, out of love, out of hope, blaming the alcohol. You know, she believes Trevor needs a daddy. And so she's going back for many reasons. And she's not getting a lot of support from Kevin Spacey. As a matter of fact, she's getting a lot of abuse. Obviously, in Kevin Spacey's words, there's an important message about thinking about the impact of the violence on Trevor. The message is good, but the delivery is abusive. In terms of the way he talks to her and puts her in a class of people, what's the matter with women like you? Because obviously she's going to have to do what's right for her when it's time. If she's going to get feedback, it'll have to be without judgment. She's going to have to be thinking about Trevor, but it won't be being told that she's stupid for going back or she's terrible for putting Trevor through this. And Kevin Spacey, there's a couple things about Kevin Spacey. That some of you may share or not share, but two things. One is Kevin Spacey comes to his work as a teacher with baggage. Is that fair to say? He has baggage from his childhood of origin. All of us have baggage. How many of you here have baggage? How many of you don't know what baggage is? So we all have baggage, and it's really important to reflect, you know, and as lawyers and judges in particular, and psychologists, we always have to check our baggage at the door. We have to think about how the work affects us, you know, how we may get triggered by certain clients, litigants, and certain points in time, by the things they say and do. So that's critical. But beyond baggage, I mean, Kevin Spacey is also pretty fed up. Actually, I often, it's no secret that most people can identify with Kevin Spacey. When I talk to a group of police officers and I say, how many of you can identify with Kevin Spacey when he says, what's the matter with women like you? How many of you would never say that, but you're feeling that? About 80% of the hands go up. When I ask prosecutors, how many of you feel just like Kevin Spacey does? About 80% of the hands go up. And with judges, it's about the same number. So one of the realities, you know, that nobody who does this work, or no experts like myself or Dan, you know, or Jeff, can promise you a rose garden. This work is difficult. Clients will go at their own speed. They will do things when they're ready to do it. You still have to confront imminent risk of harm when you're at that crossroad. But short of that, you have to reflect on how hard it is for people to leave, and that our judgment and our frustration is not helpful, because unless we've walked several miles in their shoes, we don't understand the struggle about when they leave, how they leave. And even when they leave, when they go back, when you see when Helen Hunt went back to Bon Jovi, things aren't a lot better. Things are worse. And now she's gone from going back for Trevor's sake to leaving for Trevor's sake. So what's interesting, what the research suggests, is most abuse victims stay for the sake of the children, and most abuse victims finally leave for the sake of the children, when they start to realize, without judgment, what the impact is about the fact that they're not really helping the kids. The kids, you know, the kids need a dad, but they don't need a dangerous dad. The kids don't need to leave. The kids don't need to live in a war zone, even though they may not have options, which I'll come back to in a sec. Because obviously, when you stay, you're staying for multiple reasons. You're staying because you love somebody, you hope they change. You're staying because of economic dependence, you know, immigration. If you're, you know, new to the country, if you're worried about your immigration status, leaving is different. Disclosing is different. You know, it used to be, in the old days, we'd say, you know, if you're in trouble, call the police. You know, if there's violence, call the police. I can tell you it's quite different today in the US and in Canada. You know, calling the police may not be safe if you're from a visible minority community. Again, I'm not generalizing. I want to be very careful and cautious in my words. I have a father-in-law who is an RCMP officer, retired. I have a brother-in-law who's a police officer who's very kind, caring, compassionate. So I never want to generalize. But we have to realize, even though there are terrific police officers, there's still the impact of the media and the fear and the realities of people's concern about what happens if you belong to a racialized minority group and you call the police. You worry about your safety, you worry about whether you're going to make it worse. Because the research suggests when people call the police, they want the violence to stop. They're not calling because they want to spend the next 2 years of their life in court proceedings. They don't want to lose often the breadwinner of the family. They're looking for safety and support for themselves and their children, but they don't always realize what they might end up in the middle of in this process. You know, if you're a Muslim in the US or in Canada, in my community, if you're a Muslim, you know, your reality may be your extended family. There may be a collectivist view of the world rather than an individual view of the world. Your life may be your home and the mosque, and nothing in between. And the idea of calling the police is a concept that defies your cultural beliefs and norms. So I'm raising this because the world is much more complicated as we come to understand it. Some of the research that Dan and I were doing in the 80s and 90s, we did surveys, did phone interviews nationally, but you know, guess who has a phone, or guess who answers the phone, or guess who can speak the language of the interviewer. So we have a lot of old data that's useless in terms of the cultural diversity and reality we have today in dealing with domestic violence. So again, understanding why people stay or why they leave is important. Even how we talk about abuse, one of the, I'm gonna leave Jeff a copy of the slide, so don't, you know, I'm going to go through some slides much more quickly than you can write, and if you think you have copies of the slides, they changed last night at midnight. I'm an artist. I keep working on things. So there's a great, the Battered Women's Justice Project Minnesota has a whole webpage dedicated to how we assess domestic violence within context of child custody. There's a whole interview guide about how we even talk to victims. If you ever meet anybody who does screening by saying, are you an abuse victim, yes or no? You know, is there domestic violence in your history, yes or no? They should be fired from their job. or given a second chance, sent to AFCC workshops, because the reality is that no one lives their life with a label. No one thinks, you know, this is abuse, this isn't abuse, you know, I'm a victim, I'm a survivor. You know, back home we talk about, you know, whether we talk about victim or survivor. We just finished a conference in Toronto where the consensus of 100 women was we should use the term lived experience, because, you know, because there are people who believe they're still victims and traumatized, you know, they're survivors, they're thrivers, they've overcome it. But the most part, it's lived experience. And so you really have to have a conversation. Even I do training with family doctors. And family doctors are hard to train because they have no time. You know, they have only so many minutes for every patient. And you can't, you know, family doctors, you can't say you're an abuse victim, yes or no. So the best you can do with a family doctor, actually my oldest son is a doctor in Toronto, so he went to medical school for 4 years and then residency for 4 years. He's a respirologist. I think it's called something different in the US, pulmonology. But he in 8 years of medical school, he's had 2 hours on domestic violence. You know, so a lot depends on what medical school you go to. So to assume that the doctors, you know, the think about everybody in the village who should be asking this question and trying to understand what the dynamics are. You know, the best you can do with doctors, say, you know, do you and your partner argue? Do arguments ever get out of hand? Are you ever fearful of your partner? You know, give me examples. You know, so there has to be a conversation that's beyond, are you abuse victim, yes or no? So I encourage you to look at this website. There are free materials you can download. There's a whole interview guide about how to actually engage a parent in a family law dispute. About talking about the nature of the relationship and the things that make them concerned, the things that make them fearful, and how all that relates to parenting. Because you cannot co-parent with a terrorist, period, end of story. You know, you cannot co-parent with somebody who doesn't respect you, doesn't trust you, has no use for you. And if you have a basis in fact for your fears, then it may lead you to different conclusions about the impact of violence and also the implications for parenting. Let me just skip ahead. We know when you watch Helen Hunt apologize to her son, you know, making a mistake going back to the abuse, it's a reminder that, you know, domestic violence undermines parenting. You cannot be a peak parent when you're dealing with domestic violence. You know, think about how many of you here are parents. How many of you find parenting one of the most stressful jobs you have? Even on a good day, parenting, you know, I have four kids, and I'm always worried about one of them, some days two of them. Parenting is worrisome. And trying to, and I have the privilege, I have fortune to marry another psychologist, so we have two opinions on everything. And but we can work things out, and we have mutual trust and respect. Try to think about parenting somebody, trying to parent kids with the psychological and physical impact of abuse, especially the long-term psychological impact, and then try to think about raising kids with somebody who treats you the way they have, and you're supposed to forgive and forget, and you're supposed to move on with your life, when in fact, you know, what you need is a safety plan to manage the situation. So it's important to think about what the impact. So when you're as a child custody evaluator or as a judge, you know, you have to think about, is this the parent I'm seeing as a peak performer? Is this the parent, is this parenting problems that relate to the long-term impact of domestic violence? There's a famous case in New York, the Nicholson case that some of you may be familiar with. It's a class action lawsuit where child protection authorities in the city of New York were litigated on behalf of abuse victims who felt that they were made, feel that they were to blame for the violence. And rather than get support from child protection, they were threatened that their kids would be taken away, or their children were actually taken away. And the wise judge in that case supported the class action lawsuit and told child protection that they had to revise, you know, their assessment intervention to think about what is the plight of abuse victims. You can't re-victimize somebody when their only crime is that they're a victim of domestic violence. You have to think about ways to provide access to counseling resources, housing, employment, whatever it was to, or safety, first and foremost. How can you expect a victim to be safe when the community professionals can't even keep them safe or even address the violence? So that case has had an impact across the U.S. Let me skip ahead. Just one note about when people write in reports, this is sort of my pet peeve for people who do custody evaluations, and I still read this, where people say, I don't know what happened, he said, she said, who knows what happened. That's not good enough. I think, you know, there may be cases that are in the gray area where you may not really be able to determine what happened, but you're still dealing with interesting thing is you're still dealing with serious allegations, you're dealing with a high conflict situation, and some of the remedies may be similar in terms of keeping people apart and developing safety for kids with both parents. But for the most part, we really have to delve into the issues of domestic violence through our interviews. We have to understand whether we're dealing with an isolated incident or whether we're dealing with a pattern of abuse that's happened over time. Actually, AFCC, and I'll have a reference at the end, AFCC now has guidelines. In April 2016, AFCC released guidelines that are in addition to the guidelines on doing child custody evaluations. They're now guidelines on how to think about and assess domestic violence as an issue in the context of child custody. And it's a great summary document that I really encourage all of you to read and think about. Because if you haven't, if there's a lawyer who's keeping up to date, you know, a lawyer will cross-examine a child custody evaluator, you know, who says they're a member of AFCC or a member of a professional body, and they haven't kept up to date with that literature. That's one of the pressures we have as professionals. You can't rest on your laurels. You can't rest on things you did 10 years ago or 20 years ago. The world is changing. Standards change. The literature changes, and there's a real onus on us to keep up. So obviously you have to understand what the history is reported from parents. You have to look at the patterns. And again, there's a lot more you can look at on the Minnesota, on the Battered Women's Justice Project website. The intent and meaning of the violence. You know, if you do surveys of men and women around violence and relationships, you know, you'll find probably the same number of saying bad things, you know, a slap, throwing something. So domestic violence involves both genders. Both men and women can be victims of domestic violence. But when you talk about the difference in terms of the intent, in terms of control in the relationship, the impact, women are more likely than men to live in fear, to suffer injury, not only suffer injury, miss time off work, worry for their personal safety and the safety of their children, and experience death. So both the US and Canada, women are 4 or 5 times as likely to be killed by their partner than the reverse. So this is not a gender neutral discussion. We have to be concerned with every male victim and every female victim. I'm not saying we should care less about men who are abused, and we should worry about men's safety, and we need to worry about men who are abused in childhood and have never dealt with it. So we need to provide safety and support for men and women. But we're talking about severe violence, repeat violence, and homicides. We're talking for the most part about women who are stalked and harassed after separation and killed. In Ontario, in the rates in the US, there's about 2,000 domestic homicides a year. In Canada, there's about 100. Even though we have a tenth of your population, we have much less homicides because we have less access to weapons. So weapons in homes obviously increase risk. In our jurisdiction, in an average year, we have 35 domestic homicides. They don't happen out of the blue. Out of 35 domestic homicides annually, I've now reviewed on our committee that's been around since 2002, I reviewed about 250 domestic homicides. 80% are men killing women, usually with a previous history of domestic violence, stalking, threats. It doesn't happen out of the blue. everybody knew, friends, family, neighbors, coworkers, often a family doctor, a teacher with children in their classroom. So there tends to be warning signs that are visible to many people who fail to collaborate or share information. 80% are women, 10% are men, and 10% are children killed in the context of domestic violence, usually as the act of revenge. So if you look at for those of you who are interested in this research, if you look at the child homicide or filicide, particularly looking at children being killed, about 25% of filicides are men killing children as an act of revenge in the history of domestic violence for their partner leaving. They can't get access to her, but they're going to punish her by killing the kids. So we have to be vigilant and aware, because often there are multiple warning signs. Just to let me make sure I... Just briefly, from our... We have a... I've lost track whether New York State used to have a Domestic Violence Death Review Committee or Fatality Review Committee. And there's a national website, but I haven't didn't have a chance to update myself on New York. In the committee we have in Ontario, it's through the Office of the Chief Coroner, and their motto they have in their wall is, "We speak for the dead to protect the living." It's sobering, but you know, the same way that we look for a black box, when a plane goes down in Buffalo, you know, you look for the black box, you want to know about the pilot training, are they familiar with flying in freezing rain? You want to know whether that airline had the best pilots, the best training, the best equipment, you know, because you're going to get on a plane next week and you're going to feel more reassured knowing whatever the problem was, you're not going to bring back those passengers. You can't change what happened, but you can change it for future passengers, including yourself. You know, when domestic violence happens, we can't just say, well, that's that family. The community is safe. They're not looking for anybody. It was a murder-suicide. The community is safe. I hate when the police say that. They say that all the time in my jurisdiction. There's a murder-suicide, and they say, we're not looking for anybody. The community is safe. Well, the community may be safe unless they're living with domestic violence, and whether they're wondering about, you know, what did that victim try to reach out for? What were the services available? You know, what did they access? What didn't they access? Are those services available for me? They're going to be important questions. And just to highlight in our jurisdiction, when kids are killed, there's at least seven risk markers. On average, there's nine professionals. When we look at our cases, the nine professionals, from teachers to child protection, coworkers, police, family lawyers, people who knew information but never called a meeting, never called a meeting. When you work in the area of domestic violence, one of the reminders always, you're never working alone. You know, I've been doing this for 43 years. I never do a case by myself. I always call a friend. I call a meeting. I try to get people together. Whenever I do a case, I'm picturing a conference table. I'm picturing who I have to have there. I'm picturing ways to share information. And when someone says to me, I can't share information with you, I say, maybe you can, maybe you can't. But if somebody's life is in danger, there's a risk of harm, you know, you can get their consent. If you told every client you saw, I am not Superman, I'm not Superwoman, I can't do this by myself. You know, to keep you safe, it's going to take the whole village. I want you to sign this consent that tells me I can collaborate, you know, with your kid's teacher, with a police officer. I can work together with other professionals because I need to be part of a team, because this community is only as strong as its weakest link. So I need to work with other people. It's rare to find somebody, unless, you know, they're in hiding of a new identity, it's rare to find somebody who won't give you consent. But we don't ask for consent. We just assume we can't share information. And people die because we don't share information. So one of the things I really want to stress is the importance of collaboration, and genuine collaboration, where you're actually working with people and sharing information in legal and ethical ways. I'm not talking about anybody breaking their standards of practice for their profession, because collaboration is the key. If you talk about factors, prior history, actual or pending separation, again, a problem we have in our jurisdiction now are people who are separating, but they can't afford to have two new apartments or homes. They can't afford to actually separate, so they're living in different rooms in the same house. With a history of domestic violence, it's a dangerous thing. So we really important to encourage people to find access to resources to separate and separate safely. Because when people stay together, somebody's moved on with their life and somebody really hasn't. One of the things I find fascinating when you ask people, you know, in an interview, an assessment, about the date of separation, people never agree about the date of separation. You know, somebody left years ago, you know, in their mind. They left when they went away to stay with their parents. They left a long time ago. So the official date of separation sometimes is really debatable because people have very different views about what it means to separate and when they actually separate. When you're living in the same house and you're separated, but somebody is still jealous, possessive, angry, it's a dangerous situation. Stalking, harassing, you know, with social media, with access, you know, I have a client recently who has a partner who's so jealous that he randomly calls her at work and says she has to take a picture of her in her workplace and send him the picture because it confirms where she is, the time, the date. So that's part of stalking, harassing. That's part of her daily life. You know, she can't even think about going to a counselor, going to see an advocate, or going to a lawyer because of these random calls. You know, she goes to the grocery store, she has to leave with a receipt that has the time, you know, when she left the store, in terms of how long it's going to take her to get home. So when we talk about stalking and harassing, there's so many different means to do that today, unfortunately. Depression, you know, Dan talked about a case in 1980. We didn't really understand in the early days that batterers also have mental health problems. And depression is one of the most common risk factors related to homicide or homicide-suicide. So when you're doing an evaluation and someone's depressed and angry and feeling hopeless about their situation, one of the things we have to remember is we have to assess for whether or not they have suicidal ideation, but also whether or not they have homicidal ideation. So these are critical things that we're learning. Prior threats, escalation of violence. The important message is anybody who's doing this work needs to have a risk assessment tool. At somewhere, as you're assessing domestic violence, you need, and there's no right or wrong tool, but there's great tools. Jackie Campbell has a danger assessment scale. There's also wonderful guides to help you assess a victim, potential victim or perpetrator. You need to assess risk because not all cases are the same. And if anybody says, and somebody right now in this room is thinking, well, how do you predict rare events? Well, you may not be able to predict a rare event, but you're going to do your best to identify what the risks are and then try to manage those risks and do things to reduce the risk. Even though homicides, relatively speaking, are rare compared to the overall incidence of separation or domestic violence, you're still looking at those cases that present escalating risk where that's a major concern. You know, if you're a family doctor and you got, you know, 50 people in your waiting room who are there with colds or the flu, you don't go out and say, everybody go home, you have the cold. You know, just stay in bed, drink lots of chicken soup, you'll be better in the morning. Because you have to see everybody because somebody might have meningitis, there may be rare conditions. So as lawyers, as psychologists, as social workers, you know, you're looking for those, as mediators, you're looking for those people where it looks simple on the surface, but you may not have a whole story. You have to screen carefully to ensure people's safety and protection. Just going to say I'm going to focus on a couple of slides in closing. I'm actually only halfway through my talk, but I'm going to have to try to end it. That's why they always invite me back every year. I keep you hanging, hoping for more. I might have more to say, you never know. But the important thing I have to say is we now have to think about why domestic violence continues to be relevant. Because I think the laws have changed. You know, in the U.S. now, and I'm not up to date with New York State, but in the U.S., you know, the majority of U.S. states have rebuttable presumption that if you're a domestic violence perpetrator, you're not fit to have custody or joint custody of your children. It's a rebuttable presumption. It's rebuttable. So if it means it was an isolated incident, out of character, never happened before, it's not going to happen again, you're sorry, you're remorseful, it's not part of a pattern, you have lots of redeeming qualities, it's rebuttable. So it doesn't mean it's automatic. It's rebuttable presumption that you're not fit because we now recognize domestic violence may impact someone as a parent. We know both throughout Canada and other U.S. states, domestic violence is a factor that judges consider for children's best interests. So it now becomes, you know, our responsibility to really examine domestic violence carefully. when someone raises allegations to pursue them. If someone doesn't raise allegations, does it mean it didn't happen? One of the realities we know from domestic homicide that often half of the victims minimize the abuse. They've lived with it for so long, you know, they've accepted it. They're just looking to get out of the marriage. They're looking to make a deal. They go to court, they meet a friendly lawyer that says, I can give you an hour's worth of my jurisdiction. I'm not talking about New York. You probably have lots of great lawyers in Buffalo. In my jurisdiction, you might have an hour legal advice. Somebody says to you, you know, honey, here's the truth. You know, you raise these allegations. First of all, the judge doesn't really want to hear about it. It's going to be an adjournment. It's going to be very expensive. We have to get a evaluation. It's going to adjourn, you know, for 4 months. Or we can make a deal today. This judge really likes co-parenting. Co-parenting works for everybody. So let's make a deal. So there's a lot of coercion that happens with victims of domestic violence in the waiting rooms, in the hallways, in the office, where people make a deal that's bad for them. So, you know, although we spend a lot of our time as psychologists and lawyers and social workers and evaluators worrying about false allegations, the one thing we often overlook is there's people who have genuine allegations they never make because they just want to get on with business. They want to make a deal. They just want to get this chapter of life closed, and they don't realize that, you know, the violence that went on before is going to follow them after. So abuse doesn't necessarily end with separation. There's stalking, harassing, and matter of fact, separation is the most dangerous period. Because, you know, and I have people to say to me, well, the relationship is over, you're safe now. Well, that's not reality, because if domestic violence is about one person's attempt to control and dominate their partner, the separation might actually trigger an escalation of violence because somebody's losing control in that relationship. There's an overlap between child abuse and domestic violence. So the person who's abusive with their intimate partner, you know, may also be a danger directly to the kids aside from emotional abuse. Children being exposed to inappropriate role model. New relationships may be violent, so if somebody doesn't get treatment for abuse. Litigation may be a form of abuse in itself. I testified in New York City in a custody case. I testified, I told the judge in that case in my testimony that the litigation was an attempt to drain the mother emotionally and financially, that the litigation was part of the abuse. You know, it's now a different form and it appears legitimate, but the same thing has happened. Obviously in extreme cases, we're worried about cases where there's high risk, where there's potential homicide or suicide. So these are the things we have to think about. The world has changed, so we've come a long way. We never thought domestic violence was a factor. You know, I think a lot changed with the O.J. Simpson case. You know, in L.A. family court, a judge had dealt with a custody dispute between O.J. Simpson and the maternal grandparents, Nicole Simpson Brown, her parents. So think about it, you know, in the civil court, not the criminal, in the civil court, he was found guilty of killing the children's mother. So on balance of probability or preponderance of the evidence, he was found responsible for killing Nicole and her friend. And then the family court judge had to say, well, is he fit to have custody? The kids already lost their mom. They still loved their dad. They wanted to be with their dad. They were sheltered from the media. So the judge in that case had a joint custody order between the maternal grandparents and O.J. Simpson. So think about it. You know, think about the maternal grandparents. You know, this man killed your daughter, and you have to share custody and make decisions about health and education. That case, that's where we were, but that case led to a lot of change in legislation and people rethinking how domestic violence has an impact. Domestic violence has an impact, and I want you to think about how domestic violence has an impact. It has an impact in terms of the implications for parenting arrangements. You know, if you have allegations that are isolated, out of character, a situational problem, no pattern, you might be able to resolve other conflict, and you might work towards co-parenting or parallel parenting plan. I'm not sure how many of you use the term parallel, but it's popular in our jurisdictions. The parallel parenting, you have neither parent is going to do harm to the kids, but you can't have those parents ever at the same school concert or football game, or the same party at the same doorstep. You have to do the exchanges at school so the parents, you know, don't have to ever see each other. Each of the parents can provide a positive universe for the kids, but they cannot interact. So you might have a parallel parenting plan. You might have to supervise exchanges to make sure that things, arguments don't continue. You might have to have a supervised visits because you're worried about children's safety. And supervised visits are usually, you know, for 6 months. Supervised visits aren't forever. Supervised visits usually lead to less supervision. It may be a formal community, it might be a formal supervised access center, it may be a friend or family member who has full access to the information, knows, understands why they're supervising. Or you might have no visitation. You might decide at some point that the benefit of any relationship is outweighed by the inherent dangers in that contact. And those are very hard, I've written those reports and they're very hard to do. But that's a reality and we have to accept that. We have a recent court case where somebody was very abusive for many years, went to jail, got out of jail, a changed person, and reapplied to have contact with their daughter, two daughters actually, and went to court and they had a letter from a psychologist saying they changed, they were in treatment, they became religious, they joined AA, they found God. They had all these great personal references. The mother in this case said, you know, we still have post-traumatic stress disorder. Every time my kids and I see a truck that looks like his truck, we still get triggered. We have nightmares, we have flashbacks, we're hypervigilant. We close the blinds, and there was assessment about complex PTSD. And the judge was faced with these two realities. And the judge said, Mr. Smith, I'm sorry, you've changed. And that's good for you, that's good for future partners. But I can't fix the situation. I can't put it all back together again. You know, you've created so much trauma that sometimes people just can't turn the page, you know. And that's the reality. So those are these are complex issues that that we have to struggle with. So we have to be prepared. And again, one of my, if I have any criticism sometimes, is that I see too many judges that are still optimists. Some are burnt out, but some want to fix everything. There's psychologists and mediators want to fix, make everybody better. Sometimes you can't make people better. Sometimes all you can do is manage a difficult situation and provide people with safety. And sometimes we have difficulty really naming those situations for what they are. And that's one of our challenges. This is my last slide. I'm going to wrap up, and I'm looking forward to comments by the panel. But I want to end with the work ahead. So we've been in places that hopefully most of us are out of, but we have to remind our colleagues who are still living in the 50s and still accept locker room talk. Sorry, that's a bad expression. It's not, but that still happens in some locker rooms. We have to think about what we can do to better train, what we can do to enhance training. And the key has to be, you have to think about training has to lead to risk assessment, safety planning, risk management. You know, it's not only looking at parenting, but how to keep people safe, you know, acknowledging, naming the risk, and knowing how to actually manage the risk. There's actually great research coming out about outreach to abusers. You know, so I want to be very clear that our duty and responsibility is to hold abusers accountable, but also provide appropriate interventions. The biggest challenge with abusers is not that we don't know what works, but we can't get them in the door. You know, the biggest challenge is breaking through denial, getting people to accept they have a problem, and getting them into treatment, getting them to finish treatment. The most important thing is actually breaking through denial and ensuring some sort of compliance and court review with compliance. Dealing with burnout and vicarious trauma, I think, is critical in terms of the, you know, when you, as you get into the issues and you see the complexity, making sure that we look after ourselves and each other. Keeping up to date with standards, and again, I encourage you, those of you who haven't looked at the AFCC website, you know, anybody can go to the AFCC website, and you can go to standards, you click on standards, you can see task force on guidelines for examining intrapartner violence, supplement to the model standards for practice, child custody evaluations, which I recommend all of you should read. Getting access to resources for clients is critical. Sharing information finding ways to collaborate with other professionals and find ways to share information appropriate. So genuine collaboration and innovation. So, you know, when I want to end thinking about, you know, Dan back in 1980, it took a graduate student who now is a renowned psychologist, has published a lot on the area. So all of you today, those of you, especially those of you who are younger, we don't have the answers, but we have lots of questions. So you have to think about, you know, what is the next area of research to really come up with better interventions to help judges, to help lawyers, to help people working in the family court, to come up with the most meaningful parenting plans that recognize domestic violence, but try to, when possible, keep relationships as intact as possible. So innovation is going to be the key. So I'd encourage you not to give up. I'm still here 43 years later. I haven't given up hope. I continue to write. I continue to go to schools. I continue to work on curriculum to talk to high school students about healthy relationships. So I encourage you to keep up the positive energy, because there are questions, but there are also answers developing, and we can continue to try to do a better job. Thank you for your attention.
Very lucky that you changed slides at the last minute, because not only do we have your first set, but we're going to get your second set. So two for the price of one. And I really did like some of the changes very much. I want to mention that the Nicholson case is in your materials. It's a case that was furnished by Professor Brager. I want to mention, with respect to the AFCC guidelines having to do with custodial evaluations in cases involving intimate partner violence, that yes, they were promulgated in the spring of this year, and they are in an article in the most recent issue of the Family Court Review. And part of membership includes this journal, which is a quarterly journal, and they have an excellent article and a laying out of these guidelines that I think are very, very helpful for clinicians, lawyers, and court personnel. I mentioned in terms of Jeff Whitman that clinical humility and judicial vigilance, I think we can also flip that and talk about clinical vigilance and judicial humility. And the reason that I say that is that as I'm listening today, I'm thinking of where we were, where we are, where we need to go. One of the areas that has changed is the area of substance abuse and consideration of substance abuse as it pertains to domestic violence. In the past, advocates wanting to really clear domestic violence out, not have any, really didn't want substance abuse to be seen as an excuse, either on the part of a batterer or on the part of a victim. And I think we have evolved to the point where we are willing and able to acknowledge the research that talks about the incidence of substance abuse in the context of domestic or intimate partner violence. The area of mental health is also a very, very critical area. And one of the things that I sat in on at a judge's training within the past year, and it was about domestic violence, and the advocates were telling judges not to order anger management services because they could be harmful. And yet, we have cases where there's mental illness, emotional dysregulation. So I'm going to exercise my prerogative as moderator to ask Dr. Jaffe to return and comment on this issue of batterers programs, not versus, but maybe and or in the context of anger management, please.
Just want to also mention alcohol. I appreciated your comments, because I think for 40 years ago, we kept trying to fight off alcohol as an issue, because we thought alcohol was seen, or any addiction issue was seen as an excuse. So I think where we are today is people with addiction issues and domestic violence have two problems that both need to be dealt with. So I think more and more we recognize the importance of treating addiction, but also dealing with some of the underlying issues. We did research a number of years ago where we found that we talked to victims who were abuse victims and their partner abused them when they were also abusing substances. And we found out that they were also abusive when they were sober. It may not have been as severe, but the same underlying issues around relationships and power and control often were there. So the key thing is to deal with both. And obviously the addiction issue has to be dealt with first, because if you have if you're dealing with addictions, you can't benefit for a batter intervention if you're not sober, if you haven't made some advances, at least dealing with the addiction issue. In terms of batter intervention, what the research suggests is that anger management tends not to be as effective because anger management implies you have a problem with anger, but many abusers are only angry at their wife and have trouble with violence in intimate relationships, but they're not angry at work, they're not angry on the road, they're not angry with their friends, so it's a very specific issue. So more and more, if you're looking, and there are some people obviously who have generalized angers or may have other host of mental health issues beyond domestic violence or that are part of domestic violence. So it's important that we just don't do anger management. There's got to be a batter intervention program. In most states, and I'm not up to date with New York State, some states, there's a 26-week program. In California, there's a 52-week program. And it deals more specifically with what's often learned behavior. The most significant risk factor for being a batterer is growing up in a family where you've been exposed to violence. There's multiple causes, but for the most part, violence is learned behavior. So psychoeducational groups tend to be most effective. If you have abusers with mental health issues, making referrals for individual counseling around anxiety, depression, if there's other issues. One of the best authors in this field is a fellow named Ed Gondolf, and he wrote a book on batter intervention systems. And he reviewed a multi-site study, four cities looked at batter programs at a four-year follow-up. And his last chapter, his concluding chapter, is entitled "The System Matters." The system matters. And his last chapter talks about it's not just the batter program, which is more appropriate than anger management, but it's also the system in which it's embedded. Batter programs are only as effective, as the probation officers who ensure compliance, as the judges who ensure compliance. The monitoring review is critical. So I think he has a number of great articles, but the key thing is it's not just about the program, but are the people part of the, part of the village, making sure that we're really addressing the violence.
We'll take a break in just a few moments, but are there questions from the audience? Anything that you want to ask Dr. Jaffe to clarify? Please. So the question has to do with mandated services for victims / survivors of domestic violence, perhaps being more burdensome on survivors and victims than the services required of batterers.
I think the Nicholson case probably, from a legal perspective, really describes that issue well, but in short, men and batterers have been missing in the child protection area. So if you look at, whether you live in New York or California or Ontario, the child protection system usually is all focused on fixing mothers and getting help for mothers and making them have a full-time job, going from pillar to post, trying to get all the right resources. And batterers are often held unaccountable. So it's a phenomenon that goes across the U.S. and Canada. And more, most of the recent articles and policy papers talk about the need to engage men in this issue. I just gave a presentation at a Eastern province, and that the major issue that they, social workers, and I apologize if I'm generalizing, but I'm leaving town soon, so I think I can do this. Social workers often in child protection are more often women than men. More often, I'm not criticizing it, but often don't have the time and energy to track down men or afraid of dealing with the men. So the same way the victim's afraid of the batterer, the rest of the community also doesn't really want a lot to do with them either. So there really isn't as much effort. So the child protection systems that have made the biggest difference are those that within their system have somebody who specializes in dealing with men. Engaging men is a big issue. I mean, engaging men in society is a big issue, and engaging men in treatment within different systems is essential. So that's the big breakthrough. So the child protection systems in Canada and the US that have domestic violence specialists that spend as much time fixing women as trying to engage men and hold them accountable, engage them in treatment. That's, you know, that's number one problem we have. If you look at the research, number one problem we have is getting men into treatment and then getting them to comply with treatment. When they're finally forced, most are going to treatment at a point of crisis or when somebody orders them, but they rarely complete treatment. So compliance is a big thing. You know, and then getting, one of the things I often tell judges, getting the right dose. You can't be an abuser for 40 years, you know, and go to a 6-week anger management and be fixed. You know, you need to do a lot of work. You need, not only do you need a batter intervention, you know, you also might need a parenting group. You need to think about not only your responsibility as a spouse or intimate partner, but your responsibility as a parent. And to have, like, you know, a 6-week program, you know, is crazy. You, when you have a serious problem, you need, you know, serious, complex solution. As my mother used to say, you know, you can't drag a chicken through a puddle and call it chicken soup. You know, making chicken soup requires a lot of ingredients, a lot of time, and in the same way, fixing a batter, it's more than asking the mothers to go to all those services.
A great take on chicken soup for the soul. We'll take a 15-minute break, please.